Good morning, everyone. My name is Clarence, and I want to thank you for taking the time to worship with us online today. Please let us know that you are here by leaving a comment in the chat. We have a great service for you today, so let's start off with some worship music.
Jesus. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, there'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for a king, we see. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. So Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come.
You know, there's a lot of fear and uncertainty in our country right now, and you may be feeling isolated and alone, but Discovery Church has your back. And whatever storm you may be going through, please remember, you don't have to go through it alone. So please send your prayer requests to our pastor. He can be reached by email at jerry@discoverybc.org. Or you can chat with one of our online hosts right now, and they will pray for you. So let's pray that God will open up our hearts and minds to what He has for us this morning. Heavenly Father, we ask that you open up our spiritual eyes and our spiritual ears to the lesson you have this morning. And Lord, please remind us that you are the one who's still on the throne. You have everything under your control. Regardless of how it looks to us, Lord, you have our backs. You don't change. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. So, Lord, please give us the comfort that we need to take on each day and to rely on you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Now, here's one last song from our Discovery Church band.
Oh,
Hi, it's Clarence again. I have a couple of updates for you. First, every Wednesday at 7 p.m., we have Discovery Group. It's a place where we all meet online, and we meet on Google Meets. And it's really a great place because we can actually see each other, talk to each other, and interact. So if you're interested in participating, let us know in the chat section, and we will make sure that you get the Google Meeting info. Also, you can connect with us all week long by joining Discovery Prayer Group on Facebook. It's a great place where you can post your prayer requests, chat, your concerns, or just there to help someone. Now, I'll hand everything over to Pastor Gerry, where he will answer the question, is it the end of days?
Good morning, Discovery Church. My name is Pastor Gerry. We are in part three of the hot seat. And today we're going to ask Jesus a difficult question again. That's what we're doing, putting Jesus in a hot seat, asking him some tough questions. Today's question is the coronavirus a sign that we are getting close to the end of the world? That's what people want to know. Maybe that's what you want to know because, you know, people are talking about it. There's some verses in the Bible that maybe speak about this a little bit. And so we want to know that, right? And so that's what we're asking in this study today. Well, we're going to be taking a look at some stuff about the end of time and the events that lead up to Jesus coming back a second time. This is a topic that sparks a lot of interest. Maybe it sparks some interest in you. Hey, if it sparks some interest in you, hey, why not start a watch party right now and share it with your friends? Why don't you guys go ahead and do that? Let us know that you're here, by the way. You know, people want to know this stuff, and we're going to do everything that we can to share with you what Jesus says and really what it is that he's trying to communicate with us today. Listen, a lot of people are going to a lot of different places to get their information about the end of times, all right? And here's the problem, though. A lot of us are going to human resources or worldly sources to get our information. But a better place to go is to God's Word. Why is it better to go to God's Word? Because God is eternal. What do I mean by that? God lives outside of time. He's not limited by it, okay? And so when he looks at everything, he looks at all of time. He sees it as a present thing. This is why his brother, James, Jesus's brother, could say in Acts 15:8, known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world. Okay? You see, God already knows what will happen at the time when Jesus is going to come back to earth. So the best place to go to find out about those things is right here to God's Word. All right? And so he has a lot of information to share with us about it. You can read the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation has a lot of information about Jesus coming back, and I encourage you to read that. There's a promise attached with reading that as well, that it'll be a blessing to those who read it. But today, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at Matthew chapter 24, and we're going to see the disciples ask Jesus a very similar question, and then we're going to see what Jesus has to say to them. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to unpack some of the things that Jesus tells us to watch for as signs of the end of the world, the signs of his second coming, okay? So let's take a look, Matthew chapter 24, and we're going to look at verses 3 through 14 this morning. Here's what the Bible says, beginning in verse number 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, okay, this is right near the temple, Jesus is sitting there. It says that his disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when shall these things be? What shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Now, just in the couple of verses, the preceding verses, Jesus, you know, they were at the temple. And Jesus had told the disciples that the temple was going to be destroyed. And we know that it was in 70 AD. And he told them that what will happen when it's destroyed is that not a single stone will be left unturned. Okay? And that's exactly what happened. Okay? And so in the disciples' mind, they saw the temple as a permanent fixture. They saw it as something that was going to last to the end of the world. And hence the reason that they're asking these questions of Jesus, because how could this, in their minds, they're wondering, how could this be? So he answers their question beginning in verse number 4. He says, "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, or I am Messiah, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled." Okay, so he doesn't want us to be troubled by all of that. He says, "For all these things must come to pass," but he says, "The end is not yet," meaning that this is something that's going to lead up to it. This is something that you can anticipate. This will be a sign that things are getting close. Okay, then he says, verse 7, "For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence," which is like disease, "and earthquakes in diverse places." And that sounds a lot like maybe what's happening today, right? Then it says, "All these are the beginning of sorrows." Verse 9, "Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake." So he's saying to his disciples, listen, because you're followers of me, you're going to be persecuted. And he says, "And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved." Verse 14, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." So Jesus is telling his disciples, here's what you need to watch for. I'm going to share with you several of the things that Jesus shares here. We're going to unpack this of what it is that we need to watch for. The first thing is deception. What do I mean by that? I mean deception in the way of false religion. False religion has been in existence since the very beginning of the world's creation. Think about when Cain brought the fruit of his labor as a sacrifice to God. What was he doing? He was deviating from God's plan of worship and, in essence, presenting a false religion. So how can the deception of false religion be a sign of the Lord's return? Well, false religion, I believe what Jesus is saying here is that it's going to become more prevalent when his coming draws nigh. When it's getting closer to the second coming of Christ. Is that happening today? Maybe. I think a lot of religions today, you know, they tout a plan of salvation, but their plan of salvation includes the efforts of the individual rather than the sufficiency of Christ's sacrifice or Messiah's sacrifice. The prevalence of work-based religion, in my opinion, points towards the return of the Lord. Now, how powerful are these religions? Well, for the Bible says in Matthew 24:24, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders." They're going to be pretty powerful. They're going to do some pretty amazing things. False religion has the power to perform miracles. These are religions that teach, obviously, another way of salvation. They teach different kinds of doctrines, but they are not of God. Therefore, they don't get their power from God. Where do they get their power from? Well, they get their power from Satan. Is Satan powerful? Absolutely. Does Satan want to mimic Christ? Absolutely. In fact, he wants to be God. He doesn't want to be a God. He wants to be above God. He wants to be more powerful than him. And so what does he desire to do? He seeks to deceive people into believing that his religions are of God. Why? Because he wants to devour us. Because he wants to take as many people as he possibly can to hell with him. So he seeks to present himself as an angel of light, as a minister of light. And so we shouldn't marvel at these other religions or be amazed that their ministers are presented as ministers of righteousness. You see, the miraculous works of Satan and his ministers today, I believe, just look at all the different cults of the world, are deceiving multitudes of people. And I believe is evidence of the fact that Jesus is coming back very, very soon. Second thing that Jesus tells us to look out for, to watch for, he tells his disciples, and I believe he's telling us today, and is division. He speaks about these wars, right? He says, in verse number 6 that you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. Now, the problem of warfare is not new. It's been around since the beginning of time. Even today, people just, you know, when we look at other people or when we deal with other people, we just automatically think the worst of others. Isn't that true? It's our natural, simple tendency to criticize and to complain about and to mock and to ridicule, to gossip about other people. There has to be like this major change that's taken place in us for that not to be the case, okay? That change has to come about obviously because of Jesus, but our natural tendency is to criticize and complain and to bring others down. In fact, the entire history of the human race, only a few years can be found where there has been no conflict in the world. That's pretty sad if you ask me. So how can the fact that wars be a sign of the Lord's return? Well, the key statement that we need to look at is found in verse number 7, where he says, nations shall rise against nations. Now, in the Greek, all right, the word that's given here for nation also is the same, has the same, is the same word or the same root of the word that we get for our word ethnic, okay? And so the idea that Jesus is presenting here is the idea of a war against races, okay? Now, the New Testament basically shows two primary races in the world. You have Jewish and Gentile, okay? So you have the chosen people of Israel, their nation, and all the other nations are referred to as the Gentile nations. And so there is going to be this intense hatred of the nation of Israel. And this hatred is going to escalate. In fact, it's going to come to a point where, in fact, all the nations of the world are going to be at odds with Israel. Now, is that the case right now? Absolutely not. In fact, America is a big supporter of Israel. And hey, praise God that we live in a country that supports Israel. But folks, there will come a day when America will not support Israel. There will come a day where America, if it's still around, where that it will come against Israel and that will have hatred for Israel. You look at the situation right now, it seems to me like Israel is just surrounded by nations that hate her. I mean, we just look back in our history. I mean, think about World War II, Nazi Germany, Hitler. Who did he want to eradicate? He wanted to eradicate the Jewish people. This is not a new plan, by the way, of Satan. This has been Satan's plan. If he could destroy Israel, what could he do? He can make God a liar, okay? The problem is that he can't make God a liar. And when God says that he's going to keep a remnant of Jewish people, he's going to keep a remnant of Jewish people. He's going to keep that for himself. God is not a liar. So this is another sign that we need to be looking for. Are we getting closer to that? Absolutely. The third thing that Jesus tells his disciples to look out for is disaster and disease. Okay, so he talks about this also in verse number 7. He says that there shall be famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in diverse places. All right, now God has always used creation to impart information to his people. And I don't think it should amaze us that God uses natural forces to declare his purposes and that he's going to do that again. Now it's kind of interesting, right? It seems as though there's going to be this great infectious pestilence. By the way, pestilence is another word for disease in the world. Could it be that coronavirus is one of those pestilence? It could be. I'm not saying that it is. I'm not saying that it isn't. It could be. In fact, each year seems to bring new influx of infectious disease upon the human races. It's like each year you look back and you see, you know, there's all these different things that have taken place. Or could it be that we are living in last days? That this is something that we should have been watching for? It's quite possible. Bible also says that there will be earthquakes. The sign seems to point to the increase in their number and their intensity. About 15 years ago, there was this huge, all right, tectonic shift in the Indian Ocean, an earthquake. All right, and so what happens when an earthquake happens within the oceans is that it produces a tsunami. You know, what does a tsunami do? A tsunami is this huge wave, and it devastates land once it falls. And that's exactly what happened about 15 years ago. Islands and coastal cities were completely destroyed. Many hundreds of or thousands of people lost their lives in a terrible disaster that happened because of a small earthquake. And so there's going to be an increased number of these. And as that begins to happen more and more, these earthquakes and all these different places is going to, again, it's going to be a warning sign or a reminder that, hey, the Lord is drawing nigh to us, his return, okay? The other thing he says that we need to be on the watch for that will be a sign of the end is derision. Now, Jesus spoke in his Sermon on the Mount of Olives, right? When he's speaking here and he talks about this persecution that's going to happen, he's not talking about persecution against the nation of Israel. He says specifically, okay, in verse number 9, he says that, then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And so he's not speaking about Israel here, but he's speaking about his disciples. He's talking about followers of Jesus, those who have committed their lives to him, that you are going to suffer persecution. And he said that in numerous places, that because we're followers of him, we are going to suffer in the same way, that would be our fate. All right. And so that's something that we have to understand. Okay. Church history has shown us that when Bible-believing Christians were killed for their faith in Jesus. Think of the Inquisition, up to 50 million Christians died for their faith. People look back to those days, people look back to World War II and different things like that, and we think, oh, how could this could never ever happen again, but could it? Yes. The heart is sinful, all right? And man has not changed. Hatred will once again rear its ugly head, all right? Now, this, you know, thankfully in the United States, you know, usually persecution for religion or for your faith beliefs is not something that's tolerated here because of our liberties that we have in the Bill of Rights. However, this is not true everywhere. In some countries, it's illegal to read the Bible. To share the gospel brings imprisonment. And to convert to Christianity, become a follower of Jesus, sometimes brings the death penalty with it, especially in Muslim countries. And so religious persecution and the increase of it only points us toward the Lord's soon return, all right? The fifth thing that Jesus mentions here is that there will be desertion, all right? In Matthew 24:12, he says, because iniquity shall abound, he says, sin shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. This is a sign that should bring, I think, a special sadness to the people of God, by the way. This is an indictment against those who should be standing firm for the cause of Jesus, yet he describes them as becoming cold towards him and towards his doctrines. And so how is this going to come about? Well, let me ask you this question. I want you to think about this. Has sin increased in the world? Has it? I think so. I don't think anybody would deny or doubt that sin is more open than it's ever been before. You know, in former generations, let me say this, homosexuality was the basis of sins. Now it's accepted as an alternative lifestyle. In the past, abortion was nothing more than murder. Okay, but now it's an accepted means of birth control. The sins of the world, my friends, I believe these are just two examples. These are two. All right, I could give you many, many more, but I believe that the sins of the world have greatly increased. Now, while the sins of the world should be a concern to churches, it's not the biggest problem, however, that churches face today. This verse gives a description of what will go on in churches, okay? This verse tells us that sin will also abound, not just in the world, but it'll abound in the church, all right? And the standards that held by churches will not be as strict as it was in the past. All right. Now, listen, we have a responsibility as the children of God, as churches, to reach the world. And reaching the world for Christ doesn't mean that we become like the world. God's people, we need a higher standard. All right. Not a similar one to the world. So because sin is so prevalent, Jesus says the love of many shall wax cold. And so the passion for Christ has diminished. And think about it. You know, you wonder why people aren't flocking to churches as they were maybe 20, 30, 40 years ago? Do you wonder why attendance is down? Do you wonder why baptism is down? Do you wonder why, the culture has kind of gone the way that it has? It's because sin has crept into the church. It's crept into preaching. And we're not holding fast, and we're not fighting for the faith or contending for the faith of the gospel. All right, and we need to get back to those things. Jesus says that if you love me, he says, keep my commandments. The coldness of heart among God's people, I also believe, points to his soon return. The sixth and final thing that I'd like to share with you is Jesus' declaration concerning the end time. He makes another great declaration here in verse number 14. He says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in the world for a witness unto all nations. So what is Jesus saying here? He's saying that the gospel is going to be preached throughout the world before he returns. Okay? Between 92 and 98% of the world's population have the opportunity to hear the gospel as of today. Okay? These are, if you take a look at the Joshua Project, you can go online and take a look at it. Many, many people have, many, many countries, many nations, many people, many tongues, tribes, kindreds of people have heard the truth of the gospel of Jesus. Now, not everybody has, but there's this window called the 1040 window where there's still quite a few people who haven't heard yet. But like, now is the time for us to get the gospel out, all right? God called in, and church-sent missionaries are scattering across the globe. Radio broadcasts of truth beam into the world's great population centers. Bibles are being printed in languages. Churches obviously have websites, and there's internet access like there never was before, and people can read and listen and watch sermons, preach maybe where they never could before. And obviously this isn't limited to the United States. I mean, this is like, this internet is a global phenomenon now, which is providing worldwide access to the truth about Jesus. And the truth of the gospel being preached throughout the world means that Jesus could come back at any time. I believe that. I think that Jesus could come back at any time. When is he coming back? I don't know. Could it be today? It could be. It could be. Could it be tomorrow? It could be. Could it be next year? Maybe. Could it be 10 years from now? Yep. Could it be 100 years from now? Yup. Could it be another millennia from now? Yup. It could be. Is everything in place? I think so. I don't think there's anything that's hindering God from returning. All the information points us to the fact that, you know what? That Jesus' return is imminent. This is the reason why I believe that he encourages believers to watch, therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. So let me ask you this, church. Are your eyes open? And are you looking for the return of Jesus Christ? If you are, a couple of things you need to be asking yourself if you're looking for the return of Christ. Number one question, and I think I want everybody to ask this question today of yourselves. You need to answer this question honestly, by the way. And it's this. Are you truly a child of God? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? A relationship with Jesus, do you have it? Have you called upon the name of Jesus to forgive you of your sins? Have you called upon him to come into your life and to change you, to change your soul, to change your eternal destiny, to change and give you purpose and meaning and everything that you need for this life and for the life to come? Have you done that yet? You see, Jesus does not want us to suffer his wrath. He does not want to punish us. He does not want to give us the fate that we read about in Revelation, hell, the wrath that is to come when he comes back upon the world. He doesn't want that for you and for me. And so what has he done? He has sent his son, right? God has sent his son, Jesus, to come to the earth. The reason that Jesus died, the reason that he was buried, was so he could pay our penalty for sin. And his resurrection proves that if anybody has power to give life, if anybody has power to secure eternity for us, it's him. And so what do you need to do? You need to humble yourself and say, you know what, I'm a sinner. And you need to turn from your ways, all right? You need to turn from your sin to Jesus. And you need to embrace Him. You need to come into a relationship with Him. You do that by praying. You do that by committing your life to Him. And then when you do, Jesus gives you His Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, and He will come into your life, and He will live in your life. He'll begin to direct you and to guide you in the ways of God, okay? That's the question that everybody needs to ask this morning. If you are looking and expecting the return of Jesus, if you can answer that question with, yes, I have a relationship with you, praise Him for that, okay? If you answer with a no, take the moment right now, pray, and ask Jesus to come into your life, to forgive you of your sins, and to change your perspective on the things that need to be changed, okay? Do that right now. What are you waiting for? Now, if you answered yes, another question that you need to be asking yourself is this, okay? What am I doing to tell others about the hope that can be found in Jesus? Because when the Lord comes back, the times, it's going to be terrible times. It's going to be worse than this virus ever was. Over a third of the world's population is going to be destroyed by the wrath of God. Do you want that for your friends? Do you want that for your family? Do you want that for your neighbors or for your community? Listen, there is hope, all right? We have that hope. And His name is Jesus. What do we need to do? We need to be His witnesses. We need to be His ambassadors. We need to be telling others about Him. There is hope, and hope is found in Jesus. And how is this message spreading? It's spreading through you and through me. Now, I know some of you are thinking, Pastor Gerry, how in the world can we do this? I mean, we're isolated, we're on pause, we're at home. Listen, there are plenty of tools at your disposal. Many of you have smartphones, you have Facebook, you have social media accounts, you have access to the internet, you have email, you have plenty of tools available, a phone that you can call others on. Listen, just take the time to talk to people. Listen, you have feet to take you to the park and to walk, or to walk on your streets, or whatever it is. You have pens and papers to write letters. There are plenty of avenues for us to be sharing the gospel. But why, if you're looking for the return of Christ and you're looking at God's word and you've seen what it is that I've seen today, why are you waiting to tell others about Him? What are you waiting for? Are you waiting for the perfect opportunity? It's never going to come. Are you waiting for the right words? They're never going to come. It's okay. Listen, you get better at telling people about Jesus as you go ahead and do it. Yes, are you going to make mistakes? You are. Have I made mistakes? I have. You know what's helped me to do? It's helped me to do a better job next time. All right? Listen, we have to tell people about Jesus. We have to tell people about Jesus. People are perishing today without hope. People are perishing today, and they're facing an eternity in hell. And that's a horrible fate. That's not a fate that God destined for them. God says in Revelation, He says that the hell was meant for the devil and for the angels that followed him, not for us, not for human beings. But it will be our fate if we do not choose Jesus. How can they hear unless we go to them, unless we tell them? Listen, I believe that we are on the verge of a great revival in our country, in our state, and it will happen as we put feet to the gospel of Jesus, as we really are motivated by the fact that, listen, Jesus's return could be any day now. It could be really soon. Let that motivate you to make a difference, to share the love and the power of God with your friends, with your family, and with our community. Why don't I go ahead and pray for everybody right now? Father God, we come before you and we thank you for these words that you share with the disciples and that you shared with us to encourage us, God. In your words, God, I pray that they are motivating us in one of these two ways. One, either to really consider whether or not we have a relationship with you, And that if we are not sure, God, that I pray for that person who's not sure that they will make that decision today to repent of their sins, turn from their sins, turn to you, Jesus, and commit their life to you from this day forward, to live for you and to give their life for you. I pray for that person who says, you know what, yes, God, I have a relationship with you. I pray that the words that you've shared with us today, that it would motivate them, that they would sense that your coming back could be any day now. We don't know if it's going to be today or tomorrow or 10 years from now or 100 years from now, but we get the sense that everything's set up, God, for you to come back. So help us to have a sense of urgency to be telling our loved ones, the people that we care about, the people that we work with, the people that we know about the hope that is in Jesus. God, we don't want to scare people, but we want to liberate them. We want them to find freedom in you, Lord. We want them to experience your comfort and your peace, because that's what you have given to those who follow you. I have that peace, God. Many others I know today have that peace. And so help us to share that peace with those who don't have it. God, we thank you again for these words. I pray that it's encouraged someone. I pray that it's spurred someone on. I pray maybe, God, that others are sensing a greater desire to use the means that are available to them to get your words and your truth out there. We thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, thanks so much for joining us today. If you accepted Jesus as your Savior and you entered into a personal relationship with him today, you prayed for Jesus to forgive you of your sins, would you do us a favor? Would you let us know that you prayed that prayer today? You can do that by simply raising up your hand or using an emoji with a hand raise. Or if there's a button in the chat that says, you know what, I committed my life to Jesus, would you let us know by clicking raise hand? Let us know, because we want to pray for you. The hosts want to pray for you. They want to encourage you, get some information to you. And so we love to connect with you in that way. So please make sure to do that before you go. Stay in the chat if you want. Chat. Listen, we also have a button. If you need prayer, just hit that live prayer button and one of our hosts will pray for you today. Thanks again for joining us. Until next time, God bless.
Thanks for joining us today. And if you made a decision to accept Jesus into your life, please make sure you tell us by sending Pastor an email at jerry@discoverybc.org. He would love to hear your story and to encourage you in your walk with Jesus. And if you've been blessed today and would like to give to this ministry, there are three ways. First, you can click on the Give button on your screen, or go to discoverybc.org/give, or you can make a check out to Discovery Church by sending that to Discovery Church Post Office Box 465, Highland Mills, New York, 10930. Thanks for watching, and we will see you here again soon.